Hi guys, it's Nick, the ASMR nerd, and today I've got something very special here that I'm quite excited about, and you can already see what it is. It's quite apparent. This is the Skyrim Ultimate Edition Vinyl Box Set. This is the Skyrim original score on vinyls, on LPs. And before we dive in here, I do have a confession to make. This is the first vinyl, or these are, because there's multiple LPs in here. These are the first vinyls I have ever purchased. I'm not a super young guy by any stretch. I'm 30, just recently turned 30. But vinyls are still something that predated me by a little while anyway. Like growing up, my mom had vinyls. We had a turntable. She would play them occasionally, but they were still sort of a relic of the past to me. But as many of you may know, in recent times, the last 5 years, perhaps, 5 to 10, maybe, if you're being generous, the vinyl format, like records, have made a huge comeback in sort of the popular, like the mainstream, I guess is the word I'm looking for a variety of reasons. I think part of it is like a nostalgia thing for some people, but there are good reasons why people like vinyls over digital formats, which are so ubiquitous today. They have to do with the tonality of vinyl recordings, the fact that they're analog, that they perfectly capture the original waveforms of the audio, things like that. Also, people like the tactile nature of vinyls and the vinyl buying experience. You know, there's opportunities for things like this, a really beautiful boxed set. Anyway, all of this is to say that I completely acknowledge the absurdity of a vinyl boxed set for a soundtrack for a video game that's only about 6 years old, and the fact that I'm buying this when I don't even own a turntable. I do have access to a turntable. I will probably borrow one and get it set up so that I can listen to these, but I do not own one personally. So with that lengthy preamble and that understanding, today we're just going to be taking a look at this box set. I'm going to be opening it up. We'll be looking at some of the beautiful artwork inside, and of course looking at the LPs themselves. And I'm also going to take this as an opportunity to talk about the soundtrack, some of my favorite tracks in the score, and just generally talk about Skyrim and things like that. So this box set was released quite recently. It must have been a few weeks back anyway, November 2017. And it was and probably still is available from Bethesda's online store. And probably other places like Amazon as well. I got it off the Bethesda store. And it comes in this black cardboard slipcase with the Skyrim logo, which is actually the Imperial logo depicting Akatosh, the god of time, patron god of the Imperials. And then around the perimeter, it's got writing in the dragon language. Now, I haven't done the work to translate it, but perhaps somebody has. I'm actually kind of, now that I'm talking about it, I'm a little bit curious. I might look it up later to see if I can find out what it says, but I would like to know. On the spine here, it says The Elder Scrolls V Skyrim Ultimate Edition Vinyl Box Set. And on the back, it has all the track listings and times. So, as you can see, there are four discs in this box set, and they're all double-sided. Except for the fourth disc, which has no printing on the back side, on side B, or I guess they call it side H because it's they sequentially move through the alphabet. But there is a kind of cool etching, which we'll see shortly. So, inside the case, yes, this lavish album of LPs, and we've got some of the key art for Skyrim on the front here. Which is obviously a picture of the Dragonborn, Dovahkiin, dual wielding in this picture. He's got an iron sword, or maybe a steel sword, and a dagger. And then a dragon's tail coming up around him. The iconic helmet. This piece of art's been used in a number of promotional materials and things, but it really is a striking piece of artwork. So inside the first pages here, this is Disc one. We'll take a look at it in a second, take a closer look at the record. But first, I just wanted to show you some of this artwork. This artwork might be quite familiar to you if you've watched my videos with the Art of Skyrim collector's book, because all of these pieces, I believe, are present in there in some form or another. But here they are printed large and beautiful. And this piece of artwork obviously depicts the Dragonborn fighting a frost troll. It has this beautiful blue hue, very cold cast to it. It's very much an action shot. They're both kind of lunging at each other. his side, we have a Draugr Death Lord with a very sort of gray, muted background. The Death Lords have always been sort of some of my favorite enemies in the game, design-wise. I mean, you could just say they're zombies or something like that, and they are, but I just love the styling of the armor and things like that of the Death Lords and the Dragon Priests. It's a very unique style. So each disc comes in paper slipcover. And you can see they are not your typical LPs. They have really a neat presentation. It's this sort of silvery background with this black starburst, these black streaks emanating from the center. And I don't quite know why they chose this particular design for the LPs, but to me, anyway, it looks like scorch marks. It looks like a blast of dragon fire on snow. That's what it makes me think of. It makes me think of fighting a dragon in Skyrim and having it swoop down from above and blasting forth flames. So as you can see, side A here includes Dragonborn, the title track, Awake, which is the track that plays when you start a new game and you're in the cart headed towards your execution. From Past to Present, which is a beautiful track. Unbroken Road, Ancient Stones, The City Gates. The City Gates is a lovely track that you would recognize if you heard it. I'm not going to play anything here in this video, but you can of course go look it up on YouTube. But it has a melody that sounds like it's played on a hammer dulcimer. But in fact, what it is the composer, Jeremy Soule. I haven't mentioned that yet, but this is, of course, composed by the legendary composer, Jeremy Soule. He was playing piano strings with pencils for that part of the track, that melody that sounds like a hammer dulcimer. Evidently, he was leaning into his grand piano and playing them with pencils for this particular sound he wanted. And then Silent Footsteps, which is one of the dungeon tracks. Jeremy Soule is, I call him a legendary video game composer, and I think he really does deserve that title. Many of the great RPGs from the late 90s and early 2000s, and right through to Skyrim and beyond, were scored by Jeremy Soule. And if you've played video games in the last 15 years, you've almost certainly heard something by him. 15 to 20 years, even. In his early career, he composed for the Super Nintendo title, The Secret of Evermore. Oh, I guess we should look at side B here, shouldn't we? The Secret of Evermore, he composed for Total Annihilation. He composed for Icewind Dale, Neverwinter Nights, Knights of the Old Republic, the Harry Potter games on PC and consoles. He composed for obviously Morrowind, Oblivion, Skyrim, Guild Wars 1 and 2, Dungeon Siege 1 and 2. Just such a prolific composer and such a magnificent body of work. Okay, so on side B, we have Dragon's Reach, which is the sort of solemn track that plays inside Dragon's Reach in Whiterun. Tooth and Claw, which is a combat track. Under an Ancient Sun, which is an exploration track. Death or Sovngarde. Masser, which is just a beautiful, evocative track that plays at nighttime. Masser being one of the moons of Nirn, of course. Distant Horizons, Dawn, which is a track that you often hear at dawn in the game, and it's just this lovely building of strings. Starts off very sparse and then grows into this and swells into beautiful harmonies. And the Jarl Mountains, which is a lovely track. It's actually reprised from a track on the Morrowind OST. I cannot remember. I think it's Silt Sunrise on the Morrowind soundtrack. It was reworked and remastered and reorchestrated for Skyrim and renamed the Jarl Mountains. We'll put that disc away now and move on. Here, I'll move these aside just for the moment. Here we've got this piece of art, which is the Dragonborn, presumably dressed in orcish armor, with Barbus the dog. And this is maybe slight spoilers for those of you who've not played a lot of the game, but this is the shrine of the Daedric Prince, Maerûn's Dagon. And Barbus plays a very important role, Barbus the dog, in that quest. He's a talking dog. You find out what that's all about over the course of that Daedric quest. I love the way the light shafts down in this artwork from the ceiling. And over here we have Alduin, the World Eater, King of the Dragons, if you will, attacking some poor guards. You can see this guy's getting blasted away. Fusroda, perhaps. Again, a very dynamic picture with a sense of motion. It looks like it's a still frame captured from a video, you know. And beautiful colors as well, the blues and then the warmth of the sun on the snow on the sunward side of the mountain. So we've got the next record here. And I have to imagine that the starburst or this black streaking, it must be different for each LP. I think each one, or I assume anyway, that each one is unique in the streaking pattern. So you can see on this LP, we have Steel on Steel, which is another combat track. Secunda, which is one of, if not my most favorite track on in the entire score. It's this beautiful, delicate, I don't even know what the instrument is at the beginning. It's like some kind of, I don't know. I don't know. It's a very delicate and resonant instrument, though. And it starts off very sparse, and then the piano comes in, and it just makes me think of falling snow at nighttime. And I remember the first time I heard the track was when I was leaving Bleak Falls Barrow for the first time. And you come out over that, at that overlook where you're looking over Lake Illinalta. And it was nighttime, and the snow was like falling lightly, and it was just one of those magical gaming moments that I will never forget. It was just so special, yeah, it's a beautiful, beautiful track. Short, but really, really beautiful. Imperial Throne, which is another sort of slow, solemn, deep track. Frostfall, which I associate with exploration. Night Without Stars is a dungeon track that you often hear in Falmer dungeons. Similarly with Into Darkness. Kind's Peace is another phenomenally lovely track. It's just a very warm and like harmonious track. I don't know how else to explain it. Unbound is the cue that plays after you've escaped your execution. Alduin has surprised the Imperials. You go through that first dungeon and you exit for the first time, and you're free for the first time. That's where the game lets you go and says, well, you might want to go to Riverwood, but really you can do anything you want at that point. And you're on that hillside overlooking Lake Illinalta, Riverwood, Bleak Falls Barrow up on the mountain ahead of you. That's when Unbound plays. And then Far Horizons, which is a majestic track with this beautiful French horn lead playing melody, and then it swells, and there's a beautiful choral part, you know, vocals. And it just makes me think of the Whiterun Tundra and Far Horizons, you know, sort of seeing to the distance and the mountains in the distance. And it's another exceptional track, another standout. And I remember reading something from Jeremy Soule talking about how hard he worked to get the resonance, the sound, the echo, essentially, the reverb on his French horn tone for that track, because he wanted this feeling of openness and space, like a cathedral, as if it was being recorded in a cathedral. And that's something that a lot of people don't know about Jeremy Soule's music and the Skyrim soundtrack in particular. None of it, as far as I know, was recorded live. All of it is sequenced samples that Jeremy Soule sequenced from his own custom sample libraries, many of which he recorded, is my understanding. And he uses like a breath controller, which is something that you hook up to a PC and you can breathe into to shape the tone of an instrument as if you were breathing into a real instrument. And he uses that along with, you know, sequencing software to create these tracks that honestly, if you didn't know and you or you weren't well practiced at listening to recordings, you would probably never know or guess that they weren't real live orchestrations. At least that's my take on it. I was shocked when I found out that the Skyrim soundtrack was in fact sequenced that way. Maybe some of you knew, maybe you could tell, but I think it's phenomenally well done. And that tends to be how Mr. Soul works. That's my understanding. I guess we've got to look at side B here, don't we? I think he's one of the best in the world at that. Okay, so side B, we've got A Winter's Tale, which is a lovely sort of folk type song, like around the campfire or, in a tavern type feel. A very sparse arrangement with just like a guitar and like a tom-tom drum and a flute in that one. The Bannered Bear, similar. And maybe those might have been recorded live, actually. I'm not sure about those tracks. It wouldn't surprise me if they were. The Streets of Whiterun, another one of my favorite tracks in this score. It's just got such a beautiful, warm feeling to it, such a melody. And it always reminds me of coming home to Bree's home, which is the player home in Whiterun, after like a long day of adventuring. Coming home, it's warm and dark in there. Dropping off all your stuff, your spoils from the last day or two of adventuring, maybe catching some sleep upstairs. But it's just such a cozy player home with that crackling hearth and the herbs hanging from the ceiling and the smoke sort of drifting up. I really like Bree's home. It's my, it's classic. I think it's my favorite home in the game. And Streets of Whiterun will always remind me of that. The one they fear. The White River is a really lovely track that makes me think again, the title is The White River, but somehow, and I'm sorry if I keep going on about Jeremy Soule and his composing brilliance, but he just captures things with sound. He captures feelings and places with sound in such a vivid way. And the White River sounds to me like a torrent, like a waterfall, a majestic waterfall, thundering down cliffs and roaring through the canyons, not in a violent way, but in a majestic way, if that makes sense. I think it just sounds so perfect for what it's trying to evoke. Silence Unbroken is another dungeon track, and Standing Stones, another beautiful track. Now we're on to side E, disc three. Beneath the Ice is the first one on here. Beneath the Ice is another one of those dungeon tracks, but it's one that stands out to me as being somehow very disconcerting. Just the way the dissonance is used in it. It's sort of uncomfortable, deeply uncomfortable, but in a good way. Tundra, another, I keep saying this about all the tracks, but Tundra is up there with my most favorites on the in the score. It's another track that plays often at night, often when the northern lights are out and dancing across the sky. And it has this beautiful duduk melody. A duduk is, I believe, a Middle Eastern instrument. I'm not quite sure about the history of the duduk, actually, but it's a horn, sort of like a clarinet or an oboe. And it has such a chilling, a mournful tone, is what I would call it. It's almost plaintive. And it is beautiful. It is so evocative. And this track has like a female choral part that's like this choir repeating this phrasing, and then this duduk over it, and then strings, and it gives me the chills every time just thinking about it. I've got goosebumps. It is a truly magnificent and just a deeply emotional track for me, and it always makes me think of wandering at night and looking upwards in the sky and seeing the northern lights and just the glory of the sparkling firmament above, and just it's really a really cool track. But there's more there. Tundra is only the second track on there. Journey's End, which is a pretty little piece. A short one, but a nice one. Before the Storm. A Chance Meeting. Out of the Cold. Around the Fire. And Shadows and Echoes. A Chance Meeting, Out of the Cold, and Around the Fire are three more of those kind of folky pieces that are stripped down, just like a string instrument and maybe a flute and drums. They're like tavern music, basically. Before the Storm is such a like almost a perfect piece in my mind. It's got these wonderful callbacks to the Elder Scrolls theme in it. Also a callback to the City Gates in it. If you listen carefully, the chord progression towards the end is from the City Gates. And just the languid, like legato strings, and the melody and counter melody between the violins and the cellos, and the way the low parts build, and just it's so sweeping and dynamic and beautiful. It's a short track, but it is another one of my favorites that I just, again, it gives me chills every time. It makes me feel, and it's really something special. Oh, no, I lied. I'm sorry. After all that, that's The Gathering Storm, which is on the next side. Before the Storm, after giving the beautiful description, I can't actually remember what Before the Storm sounds like. Sorry, guys. No, that's The Gathering Storm I was talking about. They both have very similar names, don't they? Those tracks. But on this side here, we've got Caught Off Guard, Aurora, which is another beautiful nighttime track, Blood and Steel, combat track, Towers and Shadows is a dungeon track, The 7,000 Steps is a very short cue, but it plays as you're approaching High Hrothgar, Solitude, beautiful track, Watch the Skies, The Gathering Storm, and Sky Above, Voice Within. Watch the Skies as a dragon combat track. It's dramatic and bombastic. I think it's my favorite dragon combat track in the game. this is turning out much longer than I had planned, I won't lie. I had thought that maybe this would be a 25-minute video, half hour at most, but it's because I can't shut up about the songs. But I just, this is, soundtrack is just so special to me. And I just want to talk about it. Okay, so. Two more phenomenal pieces of artwork here. This one, I really like this one. It's an adventurer, the Dragonborn, presumably, with a staff in one hand and a sword in the other, a steel blade, and a winged helm, and he's facing off against a bear that's scavenging the carcass of a mammoth. And what I like about this piece is they, again, the way the artist has imbued it with a feeling of motion. I like the birds here because it suggests a story, you know, it suggests that the wanderer approached and the bear was suddenly startled by the wanderer's arrival, and he rears up and threatens, and the birds who were scavenging the carcass, they all alight, they fly, and it's just this moment frozen in time as the birds are scattering, the bear is threatening, and the adventurer is preparing, steeling themselves for the fight that's to come. A really cool piece. And then finally, over here, we have Dragonfire. We have an adventurer equipped with Daedric armor, which is some of the most powerful armor in the game. A full suit of Daedric and what looks like a dragonbone sword, I believe. Facing off against Alduin, the World Eater. A very dramatic picture. The adventurer sort of silhouetted, almost. And then the back is this really cool shot with this snow all around, and the Dragonborn doing his thing. I think, well, I've always interpreted this as he's absorbing the soul of the dragon that he's just slain. This is sort of view from above showing, you know, what remains after the battle. And yeah, I've always sort of interpreted it as stealing the dragon's soul. So that's the entirety of the album artwork and all that. And we'll finally take a look here at the last disc. So here on the final disc, we have Death in the Darkness, which is another dungeon exploration track. Shattered Shields, similarly. Sovngarde, which is a beautiful, I'm using the word beautiful as descriptor too much. It's very solemn. It is, well, you can guess it's played in Sovngarde, and that's a bit of a spoiler, I guess, if you haven't got that far in the game. But it's got chanting barbarian choirs, essentially. And I remember seeing a video about the making of Skyrim, and they explained that for this track, they did record a live choir, a men's choir, that had, I think, about 20 or 30 individuals in it. But they wanted it to sound fuller and richer, like an entire army of Great fighters, the barbarians of and Nords of legends past who have come to Sovngarde. And so they basically just recorded the choir doing the piece, singing the part multiple times, and then layered them all to create this thick, robust sound of this massive choir of Nords. And then finally, Wind Guide You, which is a beautiful track. There's that word beautiful again. But it really is a beautiful track, and it plays oftentimes around sunset in the game, I've noticed. And it's lovely because it's another one of those tracks with all kinds of callbacks to other Elder Scrolls themes. It's got bits and pieces of the main theme in it. It also has cues that you might recognize from Oblivion. I believe it borrows melodies from Oriel's Ascension. I'm fairly certain. That's the track from the Oblivion OST. And it grows and builds and swells into this magnificent, sweeping piece. It's quite long. But it has these grand moments and then these very intimate moments where it reduces right down to just a single harp and some voices and things like that. So just an exquisite, exquisite piece. Now, those of you who are astute and familiar with the Skyrim soundtrack might notice that we're missing one thing here. And that is Skyrim atmospheres. And you might think that it would be on the backside of this disc, this LP. It is not. What we get here is something perhaps more interesting, and this is going to be hard for me to show you, but you can sort of see it there. There it is. Do you see? So on the back here, no label, obviously, no music. And you can actually see a lot of more of how this pattern is produced. We get these dots in the middle, which is kind of interesting for this streaking pattern. But what you see there is the Imperial insignia, Akatosh, etched. It's hard for me to show you because it's a very subtle etching, but it is etched onto the back of this LP. And my understanding is that only the first run of the first pressing, I should say, of these LPs, this collector's box set, will include that etching. Subsequent pressings will not. And so that's pretty cool. For me, anyway, I think that's pretty neat. And it really makes this special as a collector's item for me, anyway. I think it's neat. But no Skyrim atmospheres on here, and that is probably because it is a 48-minute track, I think, thereabouts. And what it is many of the ambient exploration cues that play as you are wandering the world of Skyrim. There's all these little kind of subtle cues that play, and melodies and things like that that aren't part of the other songs that we've talked about here. And many of them are strung together in this beautiful ambient track called Skyrim Atmospheres, and they're blended with all kinds of ambient sound effects from the game, soundscapes, if you will, like the falling rains or the pitter-patter of rain or crickets or blowing wind or things like that. And it makes for this utterly engrossing and incredibly relaxing track. And it's one of my favorite tracks to relax to, or it's great for work and study. It just, as soon as it begins, I just immediately feel myself relaxing. It just takes me right away to Skyrim, like mentally, it takes me to Skyrim. And of course, the music is beautiful, and of course, the soundscapes are beautiful. And so, it's just such a wonderful way to finish that album. And I'm a little sad that they didn't include it on these LPs. But I think it's because of the length. They wouldn't have been able to fit it on this side alone. They would have had to have yet another LP, and it would have made it a 5-disc set. And I guess they figured that wasn't worth it. But what they have done is they have released it now. Actually, on Black Friday, they released Skyrim Atmospheres as a standalone LP. And that I have ordered. I will be receiving that because I just love it so much. And I felt it would be a shame to have the entire OST, but no Skyrim Atmospheres. And so that's actually in the mail. And that was a very limited edition, I believe. I think they said it was limited to pressing of 1,500 LPs. And so I'm very glad that I was able to order one. And I'm looking very, very forward to receiving it. And if all of you enjoyed this video here today and would perhaps like a show and tell with the Skyrim Atmospheres LP, I would be more than happy to do so. Please just let me know down in the comments. So that is going to do it for today's video. Just bring this back out here so we have something to look at while I'm saying my final words here. So, I have not listened to any of these yet. Like I said, I do not own a turntable, but I will be able to borrow one. And I'm looking very forward to listening to all these tracks in a different format. And one thing I'm very curious about is if they will sound appreciably different on vinyl. I've listened to these tracks so many times in a digital format, and I just want to know if there's a difference to the tonality or sort of the richness or the warmth. And this, as I started off with explaining, this is really kind of an absurd endeavor because, and especially in light of the fact that these are all sequenced, tracks, you know, you start off in this very analog format, the instrument that's recorded by the composer or by a company that makes a sample library for that given instrument. It's digitized, it's sequenced digitally by Jeremy Soule into these beautiful tracks, is rendered out into a digital format, and then it's printed. Pressed onto it, an LP in this analog format. So it's this really strange but kind of awesome mixture of old meets new and blend of techniques. And I just think it's so cool. And I'm really glad that I got this. So as I said, very much looking forward to listening to it. And if any of you are interested in seeing me take a look at and gush about Skyrim Atmospheres some more, but take a look at that LP, please do let me know. I'd be more than happy to do another video with it when that one arrives. So, okay, well, thank you all very much for joining me today for this video. I do hope you enjoyed it. Feel free to leave a comment down below and let me know about your favorite tracks from the Skyrim score. And I look very forward to having you all back here next time. Bye for now.